I'm Dr. Kalyan. I'm a neurosurgeon and spine surgeon from Hyderabad. I have a lot of experience in endoscopic spine surgeries and endoscopic brain surgeries. In this video, I will explain you what is pituitary adenoma. I have decided to make this video because I keep operating a number of pituitary adenomas, and these are the common questions which my patients ask me. In this particular session, I will give an introduction regarding the pituitary adenomas and the common questions which patients have. In my next videos, I will go into the depths of pituitary adenomas, what are the medical options available, what are the surgical options available. And for the young surgeons who have started doing these surgeries, I will be explaining the surgery steps in detail, how to manage, avoid the complications, and how to manage the complications. So let us take the questions one by one. So first question, what is a pituitary adenoma? Before I tell you what is a pituitary adenoma, you need to know what is a pituitary gland. Let me show you. So first you need to know what is a pituitary gland. We'll see what is a pituitary gland. This is our brain. So under the surface of the brain, there is a tiny peanut like structure, which is attached to the brain by a stalk. This small gland, you can see it is at the base of the brain, in the middle, in the center portion. And this is attached to the brain by a small stalk. This is known as a pituitary gland. As you can see, this is just above, this is all our nasal cavity. This is present just above our nasal cavity. And this is our eye. The nerves related to the eye, which are known as the optic nerves, are present just above the gland. Why is this gland important for us? This gland is very important for our survival. Nearly 90% of the hormones in our body are produced or controlled by this organ, by this gland. So what are the hormones produced by this gland? Thyroxine. Thyroxine stimulating hormone. This hormone controls our thyroid gland. Similarly, a hormone known as cortisol, which controls the steroids in our body. There are hormones which control the production of the sexual hormones, that is the estrogen, testosterone, and all those things. And there is also an hormone which controls, which is known as vasopressin, and which controls the ability of our kidney to absorb water from our body. So you can understand that this gland, although it's very small, has a number of endocrinological functions. It controls nearly all the endocrinological functions of our body. Second one, it is located at the critical part of the brain, which is located just below the brain, above the nose, and behind the eyes. So let's go back. So what is a pituitary adenoma? Now we understood what is a pituitary gland. An adenoma is a benign tumor. Tumor medically means any abnormal growth of cells or organs or cells within our body is known as a tumor. And an adenoma is a benign proliferation of the, excessive proliferation of the cells. So as the name implies, pituitary adenoma is abnormal growth of cells within the pituitary gland. And as the name implies, adenoma. Adenoma is a benign tumor. I will tell you later. You can say tumors within our body are of two kinds. One is benign and other ones are malignant. You can, for simplicity, let me explain you. Tumors which are malignant are cancers. tumors which are benign are not cancerous. They can grow abnormally, but they usually do not spread to other parts of our body. Let's come to our second question. What causes pituitary adenoma? In 90% of the cases, we fail to identify what causes pituitary adenoma. There are no environmental factors which are known to cause or incite or help the growth of a pituitary adenoma. There are no dietary habits which are known to cause a pituitary adenoma. Is it genetic? Usually not, but abnormalities in genes are found in patients with pituitary adenoma sometimes. Only in 1% of the cases, the pituitary adenoma can be genetic, and these patients usually do not have an isolated pituitary adenoma. They will have tumors in other parts of the body, like they will have tumors in the pancreas, they will have tumors in the abdomen, they may have tumors in other parts of the brain, they may have tumors in the spinal cord. They are related to multiple syndromes. One of the most common one is known as the Menn syndrome or multiple endocrine neoplasm syndrome. So except for this 1% of the cases which are genetic, in all the remaining cases, it's usually not possible to identify the cause of this tumor. Let's go to the next question. Is pituitary tumor a brain tumor? This question is very commonly asked by people. I'm a neurosurgeon, I'm a brain surgeon, so I'm operating this one. And when I say it's not a brain tumor, they get confused. Let us go back. What is pituitary gland? It is a peanut-shaped structure which is on the undersurface of the brain. It is connected to a brain by a stalk. So this gland is outside the brain. So any tumor arising from the pituitary gland is not a brain tumor. It's a tumor arising from the pituitary. But why do neurosurgeons operate? Because it is intimately connected to the brain. So any surgery on the pituitary gland requires an expertise from a neurosurgeon. So let me be clear. So pituitary adenoma is a tumor from the pituitary gland, and it's not a tumor from the brain, but it is located on the undersurface of the brain, above the nasal cavity in the backward portion, and it is immediately located behind the eyes, and it's in very close relation to the optic nerves. Optic nerves are the nerves which convey the sensation of vision from the eye to the brain. Next, is pituitary tumor a cancer? As I have told you, tumors in the brain are of two kinds, benign and malignant. Malignant tumors are the tumors which we perceive as cancers. They grow in size, cancers grow in size, and they can and cancers also spread by means of blood or lymphatic tissues to other parts of the body. And it also infiltrates or spreads, it invades the surrounding organs. Pituitary adenomas are benign tumors. Adenomas are benign. They are abnormal growth of cells, but they do not have a cancerous potential. What do I mean by saying they don't have a cancerous potential? They do not spread by blood. They do not spread by lymphatic tissues. They usually do not go to other, they do not invade the other organs, but they are dangerous if they're not treated. Why? They do not invade the other structures, but they destroy them by growth, pressure, and by pressure they affect the brain. I will come in detail in the symptoms part of the brain tumor, pituitary tumor. So let us ask this question. What are the symptoms of pituitary tumor? I will divide the symptoms of pituitary tumor into two components. One, I have told you the important function of the pituitary gland is secretion of the hormones. So we have symptoms which are related to the secretion of these hormones. Second one, pituitary tumor is an abnormal growth of cells. So we have symptoms because of this abnormal growth. As this tumor grows, it increases in size. So let us go back to that picture which you have seen just now. So let us go back to this picture. So as I have told you, this is situated on the undersurface of the brain. This is the optic nerve which connects the pituitary gland to the nerve. Let us go back. Okay. So when this tumor increases in size, the first problem is it causes pressure on the coverings of the brain. The coverings of the brain are known as the dura mater. So whenever there's a pressure on the covering of the brain or the dura mater, it causes headache. So pituitary gland, as it increases in size because of pressure on the dura mater, it causes headache. The most common headache is in the temporal region, but it can vary. As it grows further, it compresses the optic nerve. I've told you just now, it is in close relation to the optic nerve. This is the optic nerve. So as this tumor grows and compresses the optic nerve, it causes a deficiency in vision. Patient will have bitemporal hemianopia. That is, patient will not be able to see on the either sides of the vision. And it progresses. As the optic nerve gets injured further, the vision gradually decreases, and there are a number of patients in the scenario of India where the patients approach very late, they come with complete loss of vision. As its size increases further, it can compress on the brain, causing seizures, epilepsy. And as it increases further in size, it can compress the important tracts within the brain, causing weakness or paralysis. So these were one group of symptoms. Coming to second group of symptoms, which are more important. See this picture. I have told you this pituitary gland secretes a number of hormones. So these tumors are, from the hormonal point of view, there are two kinds. One is the hormone secreting tumor, other one is non-hormone secreting tumor. So when it's an hormone secreting tumor, we have a group of symptoms because it's secreting abnormal amounts of hormones. These abnormal amounts of hormones will cause group of symptoms. That is, if there is increase in thyroxine, you'll have symptoms of excessive secretion of thyroid. So what are symptoms of excessive secretion of thyroid? You will lose weight, you will become thin, you will have an increase in appetite, your heart rate will increase. All things, your basal metabolic rate will increase. All these things are symptoms of hyperthyroidism. There may increase in secretion of steroids. This is called Cushing syndrome. So increase in steroids will cause an abnormality of in sugar that will cause bloating, swelling of your face, that will cause ulcers in your stomach, that will cause a decrease in your bone strength, many more. So you can see all the symptoms of excessive steroid within the body. If there is excessive secretion of growth hormone, then you will have an increase in thickness of your fingers. You will sweat abnormally because of increase in sweat glands. Your nose becomes thick. Your eye features become coarse. Your hands become spade-like. Your legs become thick. And if it occurs in patients before puberty, they reach abnormal heights. So you may have symptoms because of excessive secretion of one or two groups of hormone. But paradoxically, what happens? Suppose there is a tumor causing excessive secretion of prolactin. So you have symptoms of excessive secretion of prolactin, like abnormal galactorrhea and all those things, abnormal decrease in sexual characters and all those things. But apart from this one, these abnormal cells will compress and destroy the cells secreting other hormones. That is, patient will have on one hand excessive symptoms regarding excessive secretion of prolactin, but on the other hand you will have hypothyroidism, that is a decrease in hypothyroid, decrease in steroids, and decrease in other hormones, like decrease in your sex hormones. If there's a decrease in vasopressin, you will have abnormal urination. This syndrome is called diabetes insipidus. So I think I'm clear. So basically you have symptoms because of compression of this abnormal growth on the brain, on the brainstem, on the optic nerve, and on the dura mater. On the other hand, you have symptoms because of over secretion of hormones, and also you have secretions of symptoms related to under secretion of the hormones. So let us come to the last question. What are the treatment options available? This question I will answer in my subsequent videos, because these are the things which majority of you will be searching on YouTube and Google. These are the things which are not very clear for you. If you are watching this video, most probably you either knew about pituitary adenoma, or one of your colleagues or friends or relatives had been diagnosed with pituitary adenoma. So in this video I will give a brief idea regarding the treatment options, but in my next videos I will go into the details of the treatment options. And for the young neurosurgeons who are going to operate this one, I'll be telling the tricks, techniques to avoid complications and to manage the complications if they occur. So what are the treatment options available? For some tumors, mainly if the tumor is secreting hormones like a prolactinoma are the most common kind of pituitary adenomas. And good news is, prolactinomas can be treated medically. They can be effectively managed with simple medications. But some tumors, this remaining 10% of tumors will not be amenable to medical management. That is, none of the medicals will be able to shrink them. These people who are not responsive to medical treatment will require surgery. Let us show me how the surgery is done. The surgery is known as endoscopic transnasal surgery. Let me see. I have repeatedly told you that the tumor, the pituitary tumor, is situated just above the nasal cavity. So this surgery requires an highly experienced neurosurgeon and an ENT surgeon. I mean to say ear, nose, throat surgeon. It is a duty, and this ENT surgeon should be trained or experienced in endoscopic skull-based surgeries. That is, they will have their duty is to help the neurosurgeon reach the pituitary gland through the nose. That is, they create a corridor to the pituitary tumor, and once the pituitary tumor is closed, they neatly close the corridor and come back so that you don't have CSF leak. So this endoscopic transnasal removal of pituitary adenoma is the treatment of choice, surgical treatment of choice for majority of the pituitary tumors who are not manageable with medical treatment. And this is a teamwork by well-experienced and well-trained neurosurgeon in collaboration with an ENT surgeon who is trained in skull-based surgeries. Thank you for watching this video. In my next video, I will go into further details of the pituitary adenomas. Maybe in one session, I will explain in detail what are the symptoms of pituitary adenoma. In other sessions, I will explain in detail how is the surgery done. And for the young neurosurgeons, I will try to teach them how to go step by step to avoid the complications. And if at all you have encountered complications, how to avoid them. Thank you for watching this video.